Hello there, and welcome to Here Comes the Bride, The Church Begins. We are on devotional number 64, I believe. If we take a look at the book of Acts, we are in Acts 27:27. That's right, Acts 27:27. And we are in what we are affectionately calling Paul's fourth missionary journey. It certainly is not an official title that's been used anywhere, but and it's not because he's going as a volunteer on this trip, but he is called by God to go to Rome. God promised him he would not perish in Jerusalem, but would go to Rome and testify there. And so Paul is actually going kind of under the arrest and supervision of a Roman centurion, and he's taking a boat. And I kind of want to walk you through this and kind of show you and remind you where he's at and where we're at in our journey for him. So when we left you last, they had left Fair Haven, and they were trying to get to Phoenix for the winter by boat, and they thought that the winds were favorable, but instead of blowing them over to Phoenix, it blew them across this way, and it looks like the ship is going to crash or is going to be in deep trouble, but Paul's going to come alongside and encourage them. And so in verses 21 through 26, let me just go ahead and read that, and then we'll pick up in verse 27 where we left off, okay? By the way, I'm Jim Devore, pastor at Cornerstone Church of Little Rock. So glad that you are joining us for this devotional. We are in Southern California. That's the Little Rock, what you will find us in. Since they had been, verse 21, since they had been without food for a long time, Paul stood up among them and said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not have set sail from Crete and incurred this injury and loss. Yet now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only the ship. For this very night there stood before me an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I worship. And he said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar, and behold, God has granted you all those who sail with you. So take heart, men, for I have faith in God that I will be it will be exactly as I have been told, but we must run aground on some island.'" Okay? All right. So, okay. So that is the precursor, and now it brings us back to where we're at as we begin now in verse 27. So they're somewhere between here and here, and we're going to find out it takes a while for them to get across. When the 14th night had come, okay, so they're spending 14 days in this storm and tempest. As we were being driven across the Adriatic Sea, here you go, Adriatic Sea, also known as the Mediterranean Sea, okay, about midnight, the sailors suspected that they were nearing land. So they took a sounding and found 20 fathoms. A little farther on, they took a sounding again and found 15 fathoms. And fearing that we might run on the rocks, they let down four anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship and had lowered the ship's boat into the sea under pretense of laying out anchors from the bow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay in ship, you cannot be saved." Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the ship's boat and let it go. You know, you've seen that in a few movies where they cut the ropes of the escape little canoes and or the little boats, and everybody's stuck on the big ship. So that's what happened here. As day was about to dawn, Paul urged them all to take some food, saying, "Today is the 14th day that you have continued in suspense and without food, haven't taken nothing." In other words, guys, you're worn out. You're going to die of starvation before you die of shipwreck here. Come on now. "Therefore, I urge you to take some food, for it will give you strength, for not a hair is to perish from the head of any of you." And when he had said these things, he took bread, and giving thanks to God in the presence of all, he broke it and began to eat. This is amazing. Let's just pause here. The literally, what does Paul say? Be anxious for nothing, but by prayer and supplication. In 1 Thessalonians, I think he writes that. Here's a guy who lived that thought. Be anxious for nothing. So here he is in the middle of this 14-day fight for their lives on the open sea in a huge storm. And Paul says, look, God says we're not going to die. I believe it. Let's trust it. Let's move on. Let's just pause. So then he breaks bread, thanks God for it, and passes it out. His confidence in his God spreads. Then they all were encouraged and ate some food themselves. You see what your confidence in a moment of panic can help create? So keep that. There's a big answer here. How does God work his plan through individual people by them trusting that God's plan has eternal value, eternal purpose, and eternal power, showing confidence in that, then we can extend peace and confidence to other people. Okay, verse 37, we were in all 276 persons in the ship, and when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship, throwing out the wheat into the sea. Okay, we're getting rid of the last of the food now. Now, when it was day, they did not recognize, we're in verse 39, they did not recognize the land, but they noticed a bay with a beach, and on which they planned, if possible, to run the ship ashore. So they cast off the anchors and left them in the sea. Okay, no stopping the boat, no. Now, at the same time, loosing the ropes that tied the rudders, then hoisting the foresail so the wind, they made for the beach. So then hoisting the foresail to the wind, they made for the beach. But striking a reef, they ran the vessel aground. The bow stuck and remained immovable. Okay, so they're heading for the beach. Didn't get very close. Hit a hidden reef. And now they're stuck. The stern was being broken up by the surf. So now they're not on the beach. They're on a reef. The surf is breaking, and it's breaking up the ship. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any should swim away and escape. Remember, if you show up in Rome without the prisoners you left with, then the soldiers get killed for it, okay? All right. But the centurion, wishing to save Paul, kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and make for the land, and the rest on planks or on pieces of the ship. And so it was that all were brought safely to land. What land were they brought safely to is the question. Okay, well, let's take a look. We're going to go ahead and move into chapter 28, verse 1, our final chapter in the book of Acts. After we were brought safely through, we then learned that the island was called Malta. Here we go. This is the island they ended on. Okay, remember what Paul said somewhere along here. Look, okay, we shouldn't have left Crete. Should have stayed there, but you wanted to try to push on for Phoenix when we should have stayed in Fair Havens. But that's okay. I'm not pointing a finger at you. I'm just saying let's continue to trust God here, come alongside you. But listen, everybody has to stay on board, and we've got to find an island to run into because we're all going to be safe. But God's told me we got to get to an island to be safe. So they 14 days and plus a few, they get pushed across, and they end up here in Malta, okay? The native people showed an unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and welcomed us all because it had begun to rain and was cold. Oh, wow. The native people showed an unusual kindness. Is that God working through his plan to take care of Paul and the people and his promise? Looks like it to me. When Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and put them on the fire, a viper, a snake, came out because of the heat and fastened on his hand. He took a bite of Paul, okay, to the point that he was hanging there. When the native people saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, no doubt this man is a murderer, though he's escaped from the sea. Justice has not allowed him to live. So you got to understand that the common thought of misfortune, you get bit by a snake, you catch a disease, whatever, and we already know Paul's a prisoner, okay, that must mean you're guilty. And the fate, the gods, are going to get you anyways, okay? And so they see Paul, this prisoner. He you know, gets to the island, doesn't die in the sea, but now he's bit by a snake. So the islanders are like, hey, this guy is definitely guilty. Look, God or the gods or providence or fate certainly doesn't want him to live. He'll be dead in moments, and apparently he deserved it. Verse 5, he, Paul, however, shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. They were waiting for him to swell up, suddenly fall down dead. When they had waited for a long time and saw no misfortunes come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. Wow. First he's a criminal who's going to die, and now he's a god. How fickle mankind certainly is. Okay, let's pause there. Let's pause there in our devotional number 64 for the book of Acts. We will pick up with Acts 28:7 tomorrow, but let's just have a quick reminder here of what I've already said, is that we see God fulfilling his promise to Paul, and not just protecting Paul, but protecting those around him. We see Paul confident in the promise of God, and not just receiving encouragement for himself, but able to spread that encouragement to those around him. We see God providentially providing what are normally considered to be hostile natives to be friendly natives. And we see God protecting Paul from the snake bite, which then convinces the natives that Paul is not a bad guy, but instead he's a god. All these things come around so God can continue to fulfill his promise to protect Paul, get him to Rome, and protect the ship and the people, well, not the ship, but the people on the ship. Again, God's eternal plan works through, you ready? Through his people, that's Paul, through enemies of his people, that would be the Roman soldiers in this sense, okay, even though they're friendly to Paul, but some wanted to kill him, and through those who are of other religions and beliefs. Why? So ultimately, God can be brought the glory. Let's find out how all this works out when we get back to number 65 from the book of Acts. Thanks for joining us for Here Comes the Bride. The church begins. So glad to have you with us.